Down in the bot lane, the support class has been one ruled by two parties for a very, very long time. Only a select few champions are qualified to be supports due to the unique circumstances in which they play the game. You get little to no farm, little to no kills, and receive marginally less experience than the rest of your team. In order to be playable as a support, the champion in question has to be designed in a way that lets them rely more on their abilities, base stats, and such, since they're not going to be getting very much gold. As a result, the majority of supports in League of Legends belong to one of two groups, Engaged Supports and Enchanted Supports, as those two provide the most amount of, you know, support for the team, hence the role's name. But there is a third category of supports that have been slowly but ever so surely accruing more and more market share from the other two, and they've actually been able to perform rather well despite their gold-starved environment. Today, we're going to be talking about carry supports in League of Legends, and whether or not they're good or bad for the game. The term carry support is a bit of an oxymoron. After all, the point of that role isn't to carry games, but to enable their teammates to carry. So what is a carry support and what sets them apart from regular supports? Carry supports are champions who support their allies through the usage of offensive pressure, not so much lockdown, protection, or peel. This is based on the notion that the best defense is a strong offense. If the enemy team is dead, it doesn't matter how bad your defense is because you won't need to use it. Naturally, this makes them high risk, high reward. If your gamble pays off, you're staring down effectively two bot lane carries instead of one. Carry supports generally bank on securing as many kills as humanly possible. Whether those kills go to them or their ADC is irrelevant, since kills are kills. They're also pretty strong in the early game when engaged supports still have high cooldowns and relatively low defense, while enchanters don't have the mana or shield and heal boosting items they need to stave off your damage. Basically, while traditional supports set up their team for easy kills, carry supports just do the killing themselves. By that logic, you might be saying theoretically any champion can become a carry support, and I mean, technically that's true, there's nothing stopping you from playing Katarina support if you felt like it. But to bypass the lack of gold and experience, carry supports meet at the very least one of three attributes that make them not only viable enough to fill that role, but maybe even efficient at it. The first trait is fixed value. Static numbers are normally seen as a bad thing in League as they imply poor or non-existent scaling, but that's not what I'm talking about. Let's look at Thresh. Why is he such a valuable asset for his team? He doesn't do all that much damage, and he's nowhere near as durable as the likes of Nautilus and Leona. So why do people love him so much? It's because, no matter how far ahead or behind he is, no matter what stage of the game he's in, his abilities are extremely valuable. Death Sentence is a long-range hook that stuns the target for a second and a half and gives him the option to dash in. Dark Passage allows any one teammate either into a fight or out of a bad situation, and Flay is an immediate disruption that can stop dashes and the like. That's what I mean by fixed value, they will always be useful. What made Pantheon and Set so disgusting in Season 10 were those types of abilities, skills that will always be useful and do not require items to contribute impact. Set's value came in the form of his high area coverage with Facebreaker, Showstopper, and Haymaker, which could devastate entire fields of enemies if played correctly. That and of course his absurdly high base damage back when he first came out. Pantheon's fixed value was his point-and-click dash to a target that would stun them, as well as becoming immune to all damage, including from towers, for up to 2.5 seconds. He had the easiest tower dives bar none because he could tank two shots for free. Of course, both have been nerfed and are now rarely seen down there, but I think you get the point. Some examples of good fixed value champions are Pyke and Shaco. Pyke has of course his hook, his phantom undertow, and his amazing execute for an ultimate, and Shaco has his boxes, invisible traps that fear anyone who trips them off and do pretty serious damage, not to mention his ultimate which also does the same. The second trait is a strong neutral game. For those of you who don't play fighting games, neutral is a game state where neither player or team has a meaningful advantage or disadvantage and are trying to look for one. In League, the neutral is the part of the game where both teams are just dancing around back and forth throwing long range attacks or looking for someone to engage on. Poke champions have arguably the best neutral out of any class of champions because they have long ranged abilities that can hit like a truck without requiring much commitment. These supports are also viable for providing cover fire for their team. Even if you manage to catch the enemy ADC out of position, it's kind of difficult to chase after them when you're constantly being pelted by damage. This is how they exert most of their pressure too. Normally, engaged supports have enough durability to survive one major source of DPS, but they may feel a bit unsafe going in, even when the opportunity looks good, considering they have to bear the brunt of two attackers at a time. Speaking of protection, they're not completely without defensive abilities. They usually have one piece of lockdown that can be used to set up fights or disengage from opponents. Carry supports with a strong neutral game are vel'koz, Xerath, and Senna. They got long range, can harass you until the end of time, and can usually deal equal if not more damage than their ADC. The last trait is heavy zone control. These champions may not have the same range as the former group, nor do they always have a fixed value ability, but they can control massive areas at a time. Even if they don't have that many items, you can't underestimate the amount of damage they can dish out if everyone is clumped up together, or if you walk into their trap. Due to their incredible area coverage and territorial control, if the conditions are just right, they can solo 1v9 team fights. One of the subclasses for controllers are catchers, champions who specialize in zone control, but usually that's expressed through lockdown or crowd control such as Blitzhook or Morgana Root. Carry supports may or may not have lockdown in their kit, but their form of zone control entails just straight up killing you. If you walk in there, you die. Brand, Zyra, and to some extent Swain make up this category. They boast amazing teamfight pressure with their high AoE damage to a point where they might be more of a threat to the enemy team than even the mid or top laner. Regardless of if they meet one or all three, carry supports are just that, supports who can carry. At first, they were a super niche category, but have been growing in size for a while. It's getting almost to where you see them like once every 4 or 5 games, not uncommon by any means. The next segment of the video will be discussing why carry supports became popular. I think it's pretty obvious. Full disclosure, I'm a top main, and I believe with all my heart and soul that top lane is where dreams die. But discarding my bias for a moment, historically supports have expressed no shortage of frustration with their lack of personal agency, as they're the only role in the game that cannot carry through conventional means. Not to discount the importance of their contributions, but it's not unreasonable for them to think that way. That's what led to the inclusion of Senna and Pyke, very damage-oriented champions. The mythic items also helped a lot with opening the door to carry supports, since there's now a meaningful 1 and 2 item power spike. Some champions can already dish out a lot of pressure with just a Gore Drinker, Liandry's, or Kraken Slayer, things like that. For the most part, picking a carry support is a dangerous gamble. You forfeit all the essential tools and privileges that are supplied by enchanters, and you don't have the frontlining or engage potential provided by tanks. That said, there are cases where carry supports can be quite a boon for your team, if not the most effective choice in that situation. Having two carries, especially backline carries, can give you a sizable advantage in head-on 5v5 front-to-back confrontations. With all the crazy stuff in champions these days, fights and quicker, we're no longer in an age where all a team needs for damage is the AD carry. Unless your teammate is playing a turbo late-game 1v9er like Jinx, it's gonna be hard for them to put out the DPS by themselves. Most marksmen can usually only hit one person at a time. Draven, Jhin, Caitlyn, Vayne, and so on. The lack of AoE burst can be supplemented through a carry support like vel'koz, Xerath, or Zyra, who can pack on the magic damage and help you shred through tanks and bruisers, who would otherwise be really good at picking one person and not let them get to play the game. Sometimes, and this is a big sometimes, because more often than not, going 5 damage comps are really bad, but sometimes having team comps that are filled with nothing but carries can come in handy. For example, let's say you're running a dedicated 5v5 teamfight comp. You have Cho'Gath top, Zac jungle, Syndra mid, Caitlyn ADC, and Lulu support. Looking pretty stacked, and it feels like no matter what happens, you'll win every 5v5. The enemy team is Camille top, Kindred jungle, Diana mid, Draven ADC, and Vel support. The one weakness with teamfight comps like that is that you have to protect your carries, because tanks and enchanters are useless without someone to do the damage. When you're up against a full damage comp, every single member of the enemy team is a high priority threat. And even if you hypothetically trade Diana and Kindred for Syndra and Caitlyn, the teamfight comp now has only Cho'Gath, Zac, and Lulu while you're still rocking Camille, Draven, and vel'koz. Carry supports can still bring the pain with or without their ADC, so in situations where your team is strapped for damage, such as if your mid laner pick Galio and your top and jungle are both tanks, the onus falls on you and the ADC to take care of business. Right now there's also a sort of matchup triangle between the three support classes that goes as follows. Carry supports beat enchanters, enchanters beat tanks, and tanks beat carries. Zyra, vel'koz, and Xerath are notorious for shutting down enchanters because most enchanters can only protect one person at a time, while they can damage several opponents with each rotation and usually outrange them. In totality, there's no question that carry supports can and absolutely do have a place down in the bot lane. There are a good number of instances where the need for more damage is a positive. However, they have a less than favorable reputation among the community. As far as I'm aware, a lot of AD carries dislike carry supports, and while there are times where Brand support does twice the damage of anyone else on his team, every one time that happens, there are 3 or 4 times where that same Brand support is 0 and 9, contributes nothing of value, and is just Omega Cheeks, something that shouldn't have happened if you picked someone with consistent value such as a Nautilus or a Lulu. It's safe to say that despite their growing prevalence in the game, carry supports have more downsides than upsides. In my Why No One Plays episode on Zyra, I talked about how towards the late game, damage typically is not in short supply. By that point, the ADC has more than enough ammo to kill 3 people before they go down, whereas they could probably only take out 1 person in the early game. Among the 3, enchanter supports scale the hardest because they have so much heal and shield power they can essentially double the maximum health of any person they choose. Carry supports are not able to provide their team with the same kind of defensive utility, and are really prone to getting screwed over themselves. It doesn't matter how much damage you can provide to your team, since if you get malphite ulted, you're gonna die. I mentioned earlier these champions are high risk because your team is devoid of so many protective resources like shields, lockdown, or peel, which can only be filled by the support player 90% of the time. Another reason would be the trend of behavior that follows carry supports, namely in that they're a very popular option for autofill. Given that the other four roles encourage you to play high carry champions, players have a tendency to gravitate towards picks that could do the carrying instead of picking what is actually good for the team, and that's what they'll do. Which is probably why ADC players dislike carry supports, because it's usually someone who is autofilled who has not even the slightest idea of how to play support. At least if you're playing someone like Blitzcrank, if you just land your hooks, you'll be useful no matter what. Whereas if you play Pyke, there's so much more that can go wrong, and usually you're nothing but free gold for the enemy team. Can't really sugarcoat it, carry supports are very selfish picks, and while solo queue is filled with selfish players, everyone does sort of expect the support to pick someone who can augment or synergize well with the rest of the team. Are there cases where carry supports are the best choice? Oh, for sure. You ever ran into a Jhin Zareth bot lane? You have two people with semi-global ultimate sniping you from a mile away. Or there's Ezreal and Senna, constant poke damage and another two global ultimates. I won't deny, there are situations where carry supports are the ideal combination, but those are very fringe edge cases that barely happen in a normal game. Okay, so for the last part of the video, I want to touch on if they're good or bad for the game. Remember what I said at the start of the video, the term carry support is an oxymoron. Supports aren't meant to carry games, not in the traditional sense. Their purpose is to set up their teammates by enabling them to carry more comfortably and efficiently. If we look at it that way, then carry supports may be seen as a detriment to the game environment. They directly go against the expected function of the role in question. On the other hand, they provide an outlet for alternative strategies. As new champions are released, if the same class is played in a single role, they start to get redundant, as evidenced by Rell, who has an interesting design but is just another tank support at the end of the day. She has to compete for market share with Maokai, Alistar, Leona, Nautilus, and more. Designing carry supports can be an interesting undertaking. We've seen examples of both an assassin support and marksman support in Pyke and Senna respectively. Mage supports are also really common on account of their innate properties. The support role, in my opinion, has become a lot less homogeneous, giving way for more fun and enjoyable playstyles. People didn't like playing support because it was such a boring role, but now it's actually doing quite well. Carry supports can be a catalyst to bridge the gap between the two roles. That and, of course, public perception on the value of supports has gone up over the years. People are slowly beginning to understand just how important they are for a team's performance. Depending on what angle you look at it from, they can either be seen as a positive or negative thing for supports. The dissonance that comes from them doing more damage than their ADC might seem like all the evidence you need to denounce them as bad design, but I've brought this up before. Considering how much top, jungle, and mid have changed over the years, it boggles my mind that bot lane is still expected to play marksman, and supports are still expected to play, well, supports. There are cheese strategies like Ivern's support, Rengar AD carry, but wouldn't it be interesting if we could see all sorts of different combinations bot? That might shake things up a bit. Carry supports are living proof that non-tanks or enchanters can find success down there. Who knows, maybe Warwick's support is sleeper OP if only anyone decided to ever try him out. Just don't pick Warwick support in my games, please. Experiment with him in flex or normals or something. Please stay out of solo queue. Anyways, if you enjoyed the video, a rating would be much appreciated. Subscribe to the channel if you want to watch more content like this. Don't forget to follow me on my social medias and join my Discord server. Links are all down in the description. Lastly, check out my other champion group discussions if you haven't yet. But for now, thank you all so much for watching, and I'll see you again soon for the next one. Take care.